Good afternoon. We should have a little bit more energy, pun intended, than that, especially on a Friday afternoon. Good Friday afternoon to you all. I'm Hurtis Hodges, Director of the Facilities Management Division. On behalf of the Oak Ridge National Laboratory and those involved in the Sustainable Campus Initiative, I welcome you to another of our Sustainability at Home seminars. I extend a special welcome to all of the summer interns who may be here today. We are looking forward to you having a safe, productive, educational, and fun experience this summer. I'd like to talk a little bit about the ORNL Sustainable Campus Initiative before introducing today's speaker. Created out of our aggressive campus modernization effort that began in 2002, a sustainable campus initiative began in 2008 and embodies ORNL's goals of achieving sustainability in our facilities, operations, and as part of our organizational culture. Not only does this initiative include a multitude of facilities, landscapes, and energy management activities, but also it showcases ORNL's world-class science and technology expertise. In light of President Obama's Executive Order 13514 related to federal agencies reducing greenhouse gas emissions and taking measures to meet energy, water, and waste reduction targets, our Sustainable Campus Initiative has expanded its activities to include many that are essential to ORNL's future. You can learn more about our ORNL Sustainable Campus Initiative on our website. The URL is on the podium and on the lunch bags that you have been receiving as you came in. You can also access the website from ORNL's homepage under S in the index. When we started our Sustainability at Home seminar series, the idea was to showcase examples of how research being conducted at ORNL could contribute to the sustainability in our homes and our communities. I can think of no better example of this than ORNL's solar energy research that is being applied in a visible way here at ORNL and in other areas in Tennessee. Our speaker today, Kurt Maxey, epitomizes the bridge between ORNL's research, its application at ORNL, and in the community. Kurt, who is ORNL's 2010 Inventor of the Year, is an electrical engineer with specialties in optics, sensing, controls, fiber optics, daylighting, and integration of solar photovoltaic PV power systems. He has been instrumental in the implementation of solar PV systems at ORNL and was the technical lead for the installation of the 5 kW solar tracking system on the quad just northeast as you exit this building, the 50 kW solar array on Bethel Valley Road, and the 50 kW array recently installed in our new solar-assisted electric vehicle charging station. You may have seen some of that on the news or maybe even in the newspaper. Beyond that, Kirk has provided technical assistance to the Knoxville Solar American City team, the West Tennessee 5-megawatt solar farm, and a variety of other solar endeavors. Kirk's seminar title is entitled Shedding Light on Solar Energy. Please join me in welcoming Kirk.
Thank you, Hurtis, and thank you all for giving me part of your Friday. I always enjoy talking to people about solar energy. Though I should probably warn you right up front that I think I may be the only guy who can give a presentation on solar energy and make it seem depressing. I usually start out these presentations by talking about energy in general, because though you are much, much more than these three things, you are consumers, voters, and taxpayers. And when I think about our energy future, I am reminded of the old curse, may you live in interesting times, because I think we have a very interesting set of times ahead in terms of our energy future. And solar energy will be an important part of it, but it will not be the only part of it. You are going to make a lot of decisions over the next few years that are either directly or indirectly related to energy. And some of those decisions are going to have pretty substantial economic consequences. So I want to start out first by talking about energy in general, give you some perspectives on energy, so that we can start out with a pretty solid understanding of some of the challenges we're up against in terms of solar. Then we'll talk about direct uses of solar energy, which may be less fascinating to you than the photovoltaics that you'd like to hear about, but in fact is a very efficient way to use solar energy. And then we'll get into the specifics of photovoltaics, and I think that is probably what most of us find the most fascinating, so we'll spend a fair amount of time there. We'll talk about why efficiency matters. We'll talk about cells, modules, arrays, and systems, and the energy aspects of, or the efficiency aspects of each. Then I'm going to point you towards some solar resource tools so that you'll be able to make calculations of your own and verify whether or not some systems make sense to you. And then if there is time, and I think that's perhaps a big if, but if there is time, we may talk about concentrating solar systems. But these in general are probably going to be less important to you in the scope of your lives, so we will concentrate mostly on the other topics. Now, though we will talk about solar energy, I'm going to make the assumption that you know less about solar energy than you know about water. So we're going to start out by talking about water. Here is a statement that it says, the earth contains enough water to hydrate all living beings and to grow crops on all arable land. I believe that to be a true statement. I also believe that to be a meaningless statement. And you know enough about water that somewhere deep in your heart you probably realize for yourselves that it's both true and meaningless, because it implies somehow that the ability to convert that to a useful form, transport it to where it's needed, deliver it when it is needed, and occasionally store it as necessary, if we imply that that is all easy and that the problem is solved, people will think then there will be no more famine, there will be no more death, no more disease due to lack of clean water. And that isn't the case. And you know that because you know something about water. But when I see this statement, that the earth receives more energy from the sun in just 1 hour than humanity uses in a whole year, okay, I believe that's probably true. And I also believe that it's probably totally meaningless because, again, it implies that the ability to convert that to a useful form, transport it to where it's needed, deliver it when it's needed, and store it as necessary, if we imply to people that that problem is solved, a lot of folks are going to think, oh, well, no worries. Let's just use solar energy. Solar energy is important, but we get half of our energy from coal. So let's compare coal and solar energy for just a minute. Many of you drive past this steam plant on a regular basis. This is the Bull Run steam plant. It's not a large steam plant. It's a single stack steam plant. It has a 900 megawatt nameplate capacity. Now what that means is at its peak it can produce 900 megawatts. But being a coal plant, it could do that 24 hours a day for a while. Now we don't operate coal plants that way, so the average production from that coal plant is actually about 6 million megawatt hours. Put that in terms we can understand, that is enough to power about 545,000 average homes, which would consume about 11 megawatt hours each per year. So we'll think about that number, 545,000. This is a 1 megawatt solar plant. This has been constructed in South Knoxville. It's the first megawatt class solar facility in Tennessee. If you've not seen it yet, it's out off of Asheville Highway, I think. It's worth a drive out. It's kind of interesting to see. 1 megawatt of nameplate capacity solar. Now, what that means is at peak solar intensity, this system is capable of producing 1 megawatt of DC energy. Okay? We use AC energy, so we have to convert that, but we'll get there in a second. Keep in mind that this system requires 5 acres of land. So keep these figures in mind if you want to start doing solar calculations on your own. 1 megawatt of solar requires approximately 5 acres of land. We get Okay, we have something referred to as a sun hour in the business. A sun hour is 1 hour of peak solar intensity, which would be 1,000 watts per meter squared. Now, we all know that the sun's intensity varies through the day, but the way we handle that in the solar business, and you'll see this as we move into the material, is that we talk about the number of sun hours per day. So we get 4.7 sun hours per day in Tennessee. The conversion from DC to AC is only about 80% efficient. What that means is that this solar facility, with its 5 acres, is only going to be producing about 1,300 megawatt hours per year. That's about enough to power 125 homes compared to the 535,000 from a relatively small steam plant. So how large would a solar array have to be to equal the output of a 900 megawatt hour solar plant? To equal the output of a solar plant the size of the Bull Run steam plant would require about 22,000 acres or 35 square miles of solar PV. And bear in mind, Bull Run is a relatively small steam plant. Oh, and that also implies flat land, which is not a common item in East Tennessee, so it would require more than 35 actual areas of land. Bull Run steam plant, to build a plant that size at this time, as they're doing over in North Carolina, the latest numbers I saw on it would be about $2 billion. To build this plant, if someone gave you the land so that all you had to worry about was installing solar, would require about $18 billion. So, like I said, you're going to make a lot of decisions. Some of them are going to have fairly substantial energy or fairly substantial financial consequences. So when we think about renewable energy portfolios, we have to have some grounding in reality about what those consequences can be. I'm not telling you which way to go. I just want you to have enough information to make informed decisions. Now, you may think, well, we can't build a system like that in Tennessee, but what about building it out west? We could do that. How about we just annex a bunch of land out west, plenty of desert. We can put the power there and pipe it all over the country. All right, I'm going to talk about some of the, what I call the governing principles for any energy infrastructure development project. The first one is the second law of thermodynamics. And this is going to come into play when we start moving power from one distance to some other distance, a great distance away. Now, how many of you are engineers? Okay, so let's put this in layman's terms. The second law of thermodynamics says you can't win, you can't break even, and you cannot get out of the game. Okay? So that's first principle. Then we have the golden rule of engineering economics, which says after you've done your back-of-the-envelope calculations for what you think a project is going to cost, nothing is ever cheap or as easy as you think it's going to be. Now, if you're going to put a large solar plant somewhere out west, then, of course, you're going to be dealing with a lot of different organizations and states and bureaus of land management and lots of organizations, each of which have their own sets of guidelines. And that brings up what I call the principle of intercooperative non-empowerment, which essentially means that when you have many organizations and all of their guidelines, what it will drill down to is you will find that anything that is not mandatory is prohibited. Then you are probably familiar with the regional policy for infrastructure expansion, which is known as NIMBY, or not in my backyard. But you may not realize this has been largely superseded by the global policy for infrastructure expansion, which is banana, or build absolutely nothing anywhere near anything. So as long as you can satisfy these five governing principles, the odds of success for any energy project are actually quite high. I just want you to be aware of them. Now, having said that, you know, we've talked about utility-scale solar. Let's talk more about distributed power systems, and I'm going to give you an example in this case of how you can build a hybrid solar-wind energy system for use in your neighborhood that has a payback period under 1 year. Now, these were actually very common several years ago. I used to have one at my house. Now, the thing is that this system has an energy offset that is about equivalent to installing 2.5 kilowatts of PV on your house, which would cost you around $20,000 or so. But you can typically put up a clothesline for under $100. The more interesting thing to me is that the neighborhoods that have the highest per capita ownership of hybrid and soon all electric vehicles, virtually all will prohibit you from installing a clothesline in them. So it makes me a little concerned that though we appear to be energy conscious, we still are far more prestige conscious. And it brings me back to the point that you will make a lot of decisions in the next several years that are going to be related directly or indirectly to energy. And some of them are going to have to be involving lifestyle choices and what you consider aesthetically acceptable. So let's talk about some other direct uses of solar energy, because clotheslines are a good example. And let's talk first about why I believe in using solar energy directly. When you convert sunlight to electricity via any method, the conversion losses destroy the majority of the energy. That's up to about 90%. And if you, many of you probably think that any solar energy system has to include battery storage. That's not the case. However, if you choose to include battery storage, you will destroy much of the rest, up to about 25% of the energy. So All of that solar energy can be wasted in the conversion processes, whereas if you use skylights, space heating, water heating, or clotheslines, you can use the solar energy directly and avoid those conversion losses. So let's talk about lighting for a second. Lighting uses the most energy in commercial buildings by a fairly good chunk, but a lot of that lighting is done during daylight hours. I mean, let's go visit the ORNL cafeteria and see how well lighted it is with all of the windows. So let's talk about skylights. Here's a graphic that I love. This is from Sun Optics, a manufacturer of prismatic skylights. In the photo on the left, this is a warehouse lighted with T8 fluorescent bulbs. Now that's a pretty efficient fluorescent lamp, not bad. In the center photo, they have turned off all the lighting, and they have cut holes in the ceiling so that, or into the roof, so that they can install skylights, but they haven't installed them yet. So you see the lighting is not very good. The light's just penetrating. But when you add in prismatic skylights, that last graphic has no artificial illumination at all, but it is a very well-lighted space. So this is an example of how much effective use of solar energy you can get through direct uses and achieve not only an improvement in energy efficiency, but an improvement in lighting quality. Architecturally integrated daylighting solutions are visually stimulating and save energy, and this is one of the things that I hope that we will see more of as we move forward. This is a technology that you probably are not familiar with. This is a means of heating air. This one's called a transpired solar air collector. It's not rocket science, okay? It's basically a piece of sheet metal hung on the side of the building. Now, it's a very nice piece of sheet metal, but it is nonetheless sheet metal on the side of the building with an air gap behind it. The air gets heated up by the sun. That is used then to feed a plenum. This can be used either for space heating, you preheat the air for space heating, or for the application I like is for industrial processes which require heated air and using this to preheat the air for the industrial processes. Water heating is another direct use of solar energy, and it takes various forms. I'll just talk quickly about these. There are water heaters for your pool, which are kind of no-brainers. This is a polyethylene tubing system, relatively inexpensive, reliable. These tend to work pretty well. People tend to be pretty happy with them. Flat plate concentrators are more typical of what you would use for a domestic hot water application. You will see evacuated tube systems. These can also be used for domestic hot water, though it's probably, in most cases, better suited for use in industrial applications where you need a higher heat gain. And then, of course, you have concentrators for a very high heat gain. I won't dwell on water heating. I'll say one more quick thing about it, and that is, in this area, this slide you can look at when you get to the PDFs of this presentation, which we will make available. If you install water heating in this area, you will need to install a freeze-protected system, so be aware of that. We don't have a large base of installers in this area, so you don't see a lot of water heating here. If you install one, it will involve a propylene glycol antifreeze system, which means that you are going to have a fairly large heat exchanger tank also involved. So if you want to talk more about water heating systems, I think probably Jeff Christian has more experience than anybody I know of in the lab environment and can probably give you more direct information on that. All right, we've made it to the fun stuff. How many of you are still out there? Okay, I can see a few eyes slamming shut. Okay, we'll talk about photovoltaics now, which is probably what you came for. Let's talk about why efficiency matters, and then we'll get into cells, modules, arrays, and systems, and then we'll talk about some of the solar resource tools. This is the 51-kilowatt array that's installed out on Bethel Valley Road. Now, that array is installed with SunPower cells that are 18.7% efficient. By comparison, the small tracking system that's out on the quad is installed with some very good, sharp solar modules, but they are only 13.7% efficient, and that's fairly typical. That's a good garden variety solar module. SunPower is leading the industry in terms of efficiency. They have the most efficient products on the market. In fact, now they're above this 18.7% efficiency and have gone to 19.3%, which is impressive for reasons you'll see in a minute. So if we had installed that solar array with the same modules that we're using out on the quad, instead of being 288 feet long, that array would be 100 feet longer, 388 feet long. That's how much difference a few percent in efficiency makes. We are talking about crystalline silicon, single crystal silicon in both of those systems. Those are, and for the foreseeable future, the most efficient photovoltaic products that you're going to find. And we're still only talking about 18%, you know, 19% efficiency. All right, let me pause for a second. Raise your hand if you think these are single crystal silicon modules as opposed to multi-crystal silicon modules. How many of you think they are multi-crystal silicon modules? How many of you really don't care? Okay. All right, these are actually single crystal silicon modules, and this is so you can impress your friends as you're driving down the road. If you see a solar array, when you see these little white diamonds between the cells, that is your clue that that is a single crystal silicon photovoltaic module. So you can impress your friends from the roadside. Oh, look at that beautiful single crystal silicon solar array. There you go. And the way you'll distinguish that from a multi-crystal silicon array is that a multi-crystal silicon array will be square without the little white diamonds between the cells. Is there something unusual about the surface of these cells? Does anyone notice something unusual about them? Say again? Well, they're not very reflective. I'm looking for something else. Anything that is commonly seen on the front of them. There you go. These do not have conductors on the front of them. And that's a big deal. That is part of how SunPower achieves their efficiency. It's not the whole story, but SunPower is the only company producing modules right now that have rear surface electrodes. So when you look at more conventional solar cells, this is what you're typically going to see, is cells that have electrodes on the front. Now, we've talked about single crystal silicon. Let's talk about what that means for a minute. This is an example of a 1970s era single crystal silicon photocell. It's round. And the reason it's round is because that single crystal of silicon is grown through a process called the Czochralski method, which is kind of like making rock candy, except making it in silicon, except that it's only one single crystal, whereas rock candy is lots of crystals. So we draw one single crystal out of a vat of molten silicon in order to produce a long, round boule of silicon, and that is then sliced into wafers to make the cells. This is a more modern single cell, single crystal silicon cell. These corners are why you have the white diamonds between the cells in a photovoltaic module. Because you can see what's happened is this was a single round cell to begin with, and then the sides were lopped off so that you could fit more PV area into a modular space. And then this is a multicrystal silicon cell. So these are the ones that you will be able to impress your friends and say, oh, well, that one's a multicrystal silicon array. Let's talk for a moment about efficiency. How many of you have heard about a 40% efficient solar cell? All right, you will hear about them. Let me explain why they are not relevant to most of your life. We have something called the Shockley-Kaiser limit. And that is the theoretical limit for a single junction solar cell efficiency, and it is about 30%. It was calculated back in the 60s. There are a number of factors that limit the ability to achieve that. In other words, you won't ever get to that from a practical standpoint. That is the theoretical limit. We actually think the engineering limit is probably going to roll off around 26%, and we may get there eventually. But bear in mind, right now, SunPower is manufacturing cells at 24.2%, I think they have demonstrated. They're routinely manufacturing at 22%, and I think they are starting into production on this one, or maybe are in full production on this one. So we are essentially asymptotically approaching the practical limit. So in other words, photovoltaic modules are not going to get much more efficient than they are today. There are some emerging technologies. None of them competes with silicon, with crystalline silicon yet. And we'll talk about that. This is an example of a 40% efficient solar cells, and this is why it will probably never be relevant to you. This is a cell that is a multi-junction cell. It's very interesting how it works and how they achieve the efficiency. What happens is the shorter wavelengths, or blue light, are converted in an upper level. Then the longer wavelengths, going all the way to the red and the infrared, are converted in successive levels. So the light actually is transmitted through the multiple levels of the solar cell. But you can see how many junctions are involved in this. And in fact, in order to produce this, you have to produce a fairly exotic junction called a tunnel diode junction in between some of the layers. These things are extraordinarily expensive. So they will never be practical. I think I am safe in saying that, knowing something about how semiconductors are made. If it ever becomes practical, please come back and see me. But I think I'm safe saying you will never see these in a commercial PV system that you can afford to use. The things that you will probably see for the foreseeable future that will have enough efficiency to be impressive will be photovoltaic modules made of silicon. And again, here are multi-crystal silicon and single-crystal silicon examples. And here are some representative examples. So you can see that these start out at almost 14% and again go up to about 19.3%. That's where we're at in terms of efficiency. Now, what does that mean? Well, I said a few minutes ago, you've got 1,000 watts per square meter coming in from the sun at peak intensity. So let's say you had one square meter module. If it was 100%, then you'd get 1,000 watts out. If it was 20% efficient, you'd get about 200 watts out. So in the best cases, that's about where we're at. 200 watt modules, or 20% efficient modules, give you about 200 watts out per square meter. You'll hear a lot about thin film photovoltaics. And thin film photovoltaic technologies have some real advantages. They offer flexibility, lightweight, and potentially lower cost. But they do so at the expense of efficiency. And I'm going to just cite a few of the technologies that I think are probably most relevant to you. And really, this is it. These are the leading contenders. There are other things emerging, but these are the things that you could buy at this time. Amorphous silicon is a very well-established technology. Unisolar Ovonics manufactures these modules. An interesting thing is that if you look at a data sheet for a Unisolar Ovonics product, they won't actually quote you the module efficiency. You actually will have to do that math for yourself, taking the dimensions of the solar module and assuming 1,000 watts per square meter and looking at the output. But when you do that, you'll find out these are only 6 to 7% efficient, so about a third to a half as efficient as silicon. There is a technology that is potentially going to be a contender against silicon. At least in the laboratory now, we have seen 19.5% efficient cells, and that's getting close to the efficiency of a silicon cell. And this is a technology known as CIGS, or copper indium gallium diselenide. I think CIGS is a technology to watch. It's only recently that products have actually begun emerging on the market, but CIGS is out there. I do think that it's going to be an important product for us. Cadmium telluride has been out there for a while, and there is one company that is essentially leading that entire industry, and that's a company called First Solar. First Solar is installing multi-megawatt arrays on multiple continents. They have a cell efficiency of about 16% and a module efficiency of about 10%, which isn't great, but the thing First Solar has been striving for is to get below the dollar per watt manufacturing limit. Right now, typical solar modules, I think, are still running about $1.70 a watt manufacturing costs. They have aimed to get below the dollar per watt manufacturing cost, and I think they're there at this point. So it's a good technology. The thing that may be the Achilles heel of these two technologies is that we have a lot of silicon on the Earth, but tellurium and cadmium are in less abundance, and so these two technologies are going to be limited by them. Also, the cadmium toxicity is an issue, and we can talk more about that at another time if you like. All right, so we made our way from cells to modules. We're rapidly approaching arrays. How many of you are still with me out there? You're doing pretty well. Thank you. So a photovoltaic array is now composed of multiple modules, just like a module was composed of multiple cells. And the way we do that is the voltage for any given module may only be probably 20 to 60 volts DC typically, but we arrange these modules in series strings to reach a higher voltage, and then we arrange the strings in parallel to give us a higher current, and that's how all of our solar arrays are made up, almost all of them. There's one exception. The thing to keep in mind is we really abhor shading on any photovoltaic array, and the reason is that we have connected these in series, so if you shade one module in this string, you really knock the output of the entire string down. Okay, granted, there are bypass diodes and things that help, but essentially you can wipe out most of the production of a single string by shading any portion of a module. So, we don't want any shading for that reason. We use something called an inverter to convert the DC to AC, and that inverter will operate with something called maximum power point tracking, which will hold the output of the entire system right at the knee of the curve in order to give us the most efficiency over time, because we have to get as much efficiency out of solar as we can in order to hope to make it cost effective. Now, there is a technology that you'll see in a second in the inverter realm. Inverters come in a lot of different shapes and sizes. This is a 50 kilowatt inverter. This is the size that we actually have out on our 50 kilowatt array, or it's the one that converts the energy from our 50 kilowatt array. This is a 5 kilowatt Sunny Boy inverter. This is what you will see, aside from the fact that ours has a white case, not an orange one. This is what you will see on the back of the tracking system out on the quad. Sometimes we stack these up into a tower so that we can actually do larger amounts of energy, like multiple or tens of kilowatts. Sometimes we do use batteries with solar systems, and we may use an inverter charger. We actually are using an inverter charger on the battery storage system at the new solar-assisted parking facility. And this is the technology I want you to keep in the back of your mind. This is something called a microinverter. And in this instance, the inverter is not one large system that handles the entire array. It's an inverter that is used with each individual module. Now, that's kind of a big deal because it can open up some new horizons for us. I said before, we absolutely abhor shading on any part of a solar module. But if we have microinverters, so we have one inverter per module, and you shade a module, you only affect the output of that inverter or of that module. So, in fact, microinverters have only been on the market for, I'd say, 5 years. I would not be surprised if we see within the next 10 years, I could see us reaching a point where when you buy a photovoltaic module, the concept of not buying it with an inverter built into it, it may seem bizarre, because I actually think this might be where the industry goes. But that's just my speculation. There are some issues with this, because if you have a failure of an inverter, now, instead of dealing with one inverter, you're dealing with, well, in the case of our solar-assisted parking facility, there are 210 modules. So that means potentially 210 maintenance issues in terms of inverters. So it's a technology to watch. I'm not ready to use them on any of the arrays that I've put in yet. All right, so let's talk a little more about PV system efficiency, some of the considerations to keep in mind, and talk about some of the tools that you can use to look at system efficiency. The Bethel Valley Road Array is a fixed tilt array, latitude tilt. That's typically what we do to maximize the output over the course of a year. So that is a fixed array. We have a single axis tracking array out here on the quad. So let's look at that in a moment. Then we'll talk about sun charts and some self-shading issues with arrays. We'll go into more detail about the DC to AC conversion losses, and then I'm going to introduce you to some tools, the Redbook, the PV Watts calculator, and the MB calculator, and then we'll talk quickly about the Pathfinder instrument. This is a little confusing, but let me step you through this graphic. This green line represents what would happen if we had a south-facing wall of a building and we mounted our photovoltaic modules on that south-facing wall so that they were vertical. You can see we don't get a lot of variation throughout the year in terms of output, but we also don't get much output at any time of the year. So vertical orientation is, it's not that it's never done, but it's not very efficient. A purely horizontal system would give you the most output, more so than a tilted system, during the summer months because the sun's more overhead, but you're going to lose at the extremes of the year. So typically we will go with a latitude tilt, as you see with the yellow line. That's just commonly how we do it because that gives you the best output over the course of a year. We can apply a tracking system, and if we use a single axis tracking system, that's what you see in the blue, light blue line. Once in a while, we will use a dual axis tracking system. That's the darker blue line. Now, the problem with the tracking system is you do have another maintenance issue. Photovoltaic systems are actually pretty maintenance free unless you put a tracker with them. And I don't want any of you to remind me that the tracker in the quad went for a year without tracking. Okay, let's not even bring it up. All right, so maintenance issues can be a factor. And if you've got a dual axis tracking system, you've got twice as many maintenance issues to consider, and you only gain a very small additional advantage in terms of efficiency. So that's where we're at in terms of tilt, and that's why you will see different options as far as how systems are mounted. This is a sun chart, and when you look at the links on these different slides, this will take you to a location where you can create your own sun chart for your location. This is one for Oak Ridge. And the thing I was particularly interested in this case is at the winter solstice, I want to know what angle I have to be at to avoid self-shading from the hours of 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. solar time, not local time. So solar time means the sun is straight overhead at noon. And it turns out that that's around 18 degrees. So when we put a photovoltaic system on the ground, like the megawatt system out in South Knoxville, you'll notice that there is spacing between the arrays. And there is just enough spacing between the arrays so that at the winter solstice, we do not shade one array by the other between the hours of 9 and 3. I mean, that's typically how we would do this. The DC to AC conversion efficiency. We use AC in our homes and businesses. Tesla won the debate, okay? So we use AC as opposed to DC distribution in this everywhere. And there are a lot of good reasons for that, but it means that we have to convert our DC to AC. I'm going to show you how to get to the PV Watts calculator. When you get to the PV Watts calculator, you will be able to look at all of the factors that go into this D rate. And the default D rate in the PV Watts calculator is 77%. Now, that's based on a lot of different data. Most of us are a little more optimistic and, in fact, are seeing better results on the systems that we're putting in. So I will typically use an 80% conversion factor converting the DC to AC. It's a little misleading to call it that conversion because that implies that it's only the DC to AC conversion that's taken into account. And in fact, inverters are actually pretty efficient, but this takes into account a lot of different factors. You'll be able to drill down through these and see how much each one contributes. You will get there through what's called the PV Watts calculator. The PV Watts calculator is based on these data. This is something you can easily find by Googling Redbook or NREL Redbook. And for many cities throughout the country, you'll be able to find data that will tell you for various degrees of tilt how many sun hours you will get for each month, and then the average sun hours per year. And as I said before, in this area, we get 4.7 sun hours per year average throughout the year, or 4.7 per day average throughout the year. This is the PV Watts calculator, which is largely based on the data that are used in the Red Book, but this is a pretty cool calculator. You can actually go into this and put in a lot of parameters. It's very user-friendly. You'll figure it out rather quickly, so I'm not going to dwell on it. But if you push this button on the D-rate factor help, it will show you that that graphic that I brought up a couple of minutes ago and show you what goes into that D-rate with the default of 77%. This is a cool tool. This one, again, was developed by NREL. It's called In My Backyard, or EMBY. And this is kind of neat because you can enter an address and it will bring up a Google map, and you can use that Google map and then draw a solar system. I drew a little square system on a building in downtown Knoxville, just out of curiosity. When you do that, then you can enter some additional information, I think, regarding the tilt and this and that. And anyhow, when you push go, you will get a nice printout of what you could get in terms of output from that system. Now, this is only based on a 2D satellite picture, so this does not take into account, for example, if you happen to have air conditioning systems and other things that create shading on the roof that might interfere with the photovoltaic array. So you have to apply this tool judiciously, but it is a pretty darn handy tool and a nice way for you to go and look at your address of your home, and you can start drawing little solar systems on your roof. In order to account for shading, which, as I said, that does not, we actually use some instruments that let us measure the shading that is going to be created by trees, buildings, whatever is in our perimeter. This is a really handy little device. It's called the Solar Pathfinder. With the software, I think this thing runs about $350. I'll show you how you use it. This one is, I think, still over $1,200. I have used both. I really prefer this one. I know what this one's giving me. I have had some rather bizarre results using one of these that I borrowed. This one, I can intuitively check the results, and it's really pretty straightforward to use. The way that device is used is you take a digital photograph looking straight down on the lens of this thing after you've leveled it and aligned it to south. When you do that, you will get a photograph that shows you the height of the trees and buildings that are in the perimeter area, and that will allow you, there's actually a chart on this where you can intuitively interpret the data visually, but spend the extra $100, buy the software, draw the little squiggly line, and once you draw the little squiggly line, then push go, and you'll get a nice report that tells you about the efficiency if there were no shading, the efficiency, if it were lined due south and had no shading, if whatever angle you intend to align it at and had no shade and had no shading, and then ultimately what the effect is of the shading and the angle that you're orienting at. So typically, though we would like to orient photovoltaic systems at 180 degrees facing due south, most of the time, because of the ridge and valley system in East Tennessee, you're going to find that we're about, I think, 30 degrees off from that, something like that. But it only costs us a small percent. All right. At this point, I was going to move into a discussion of concentrator photovoltaics, but I thought it would be good. We have about 13 till. Maybe we should pause at this point and see if there are questions that you would like to have me address. And then if we still have time, we can talk about concentrator photovoltaics. Yes.
A few years back, there was sort of an infamous report that came out in regards to the energy that takes to manufacture solar panels and the lifetime output of the photovoltaic panel itself. Can you talk about that?
The question is, related to embedded energy costs. And what he has said is that a few years back there was a kind of an infamous report that discussed the amount of energy required to produce photovoltaic modules versus the amount of energy that they would produce then over their lifetime and comparing the two. And it was somewhat controversial. So, sorry, we don't discuss controversial reports. Now, actually, I don't know the details on that report. But yeah, I know for sure that the costs, the embedded energy costs, and that is everything that is manufactured, including a Nissan Leaf, has an embedded energy cost. And so we have to think about those when we look at the life cycle energy effects. I know that it has gotten better. I think that the topic is much less controversial than it was, say, 10 years ago. But I don't have specifics for you. Yes? So the question really relates to the fact that if you look at the hours that the sun shines and you look at the hours that we use the most energy, there is a phase lag between the two. So our solar energy production peaks in the middle of the day, then we all leave work, go home, turn on air conditioners and cook dinner, etc. And we hit an electrical consumption peak after our solar production peak has begun to decline. So if we know that we have significant round-trip losses associated with battery storage, lead-acid batteries will typically cost you about 25% loss, round-trip loss in the charge-discharge cycle. So maybe we don't want to use lead-acid storage. At some point, maybe we would go with a more efficient battery system. There are some bromine battery technologies that look promising that may have much lower round-trip charge-discharge losses. Lithium-ion batteries have very low round-trip discharge losses. On the order, someone told me the other day, of less than 5% as opposed to 25%. I can't validate that number for you right now. Eventually, as electric vehicles proliferate, we are looking at the possibility that battery packs that are no longer particularly useful in the vehicle may still be quite useful as a second use category as an energy storage option for solar systems. So that's another possibility. But your question really brings us back to concentrator photovoltaics. So let's move into that. And concentrating systems in general. I'm going to start with concentrator photovoltaics first. Concentrator photovoltaic systems are systems that use optics to focus light onto solar cells so that the concept is that it should be always cheaper to produce a mirror or a lens than it is to produce a solar cell. I mean, to a first approximation. And so the idea is, and some of these have quite high concentrations. There are three types out there. There is a Fresnel lens concentrator. There are aspheric mirror concentrators. And then this is something, actually we had the beta test of the very first module using this in the US. This is something called a low concentration system. It's a very simple concept. It just involves flat mirrors made of relatively inexpensive aluminum, very highly reflective aluminum, a product known as Alinod. That's a trade name. So these concentrating systems allow us to replace expensive solar cells with less expensive optics. That's the concept. You will see these in various implementations. This is an Aminex product. Aminex makes a billboard-sized solar array. Each of these modules consists of a Fresnel lens concentrating light several hundred times to a relatively small, I think it is single crystal silicon cell. And so this requires two-axis tracking. I talked earlier about tracking, and I was saying that there really is no significant advantage of two-axis versus single-axis? Well, let me back up and regroup. When we are talking about tracking, when we're talking about concentrating systems, we have to have two-axis tracking. I mean, in the case of the low-concentration system with the flat mirrors, we used single-axis tracking, but this type of system not only requires two-axis tracking, it requires very, very accurate two-axis tracking. In our hybrid lighting system that you might recall hearing about, we used a solar concentrator to concentrate light several hundred times and bring it inside for lighting. We brought it in through a fiber optic bundle. That system required tracking. It was what we call an open loop tracker. That is, it had no sun pointer to see where the sun is. It was based on astronomical equations. It was very reliable, actually. And that tracker is typically, that's the method that's typically used for this type of accuracy. That tracker required 1/8 degree tracking accuracy. The Aminex system has a higher concentration ratio. They not only use open loop tracking in order to follow the sun, they follow it with closed loop tracking to get even tighter tolerances. And I don't know what these, I know they're well below 10th degree tracking accuracy, but I don't know how much lower. I mentioned that there were aspheric mirror concentrators. This is another company that's out there called Soul Focus, and this uses the aspheric mirror concentrator that I described a moment ago. So the Aminex was Fresnel lens, Soul Focus is aspheric mirror, and the other one that I talked about was the planar mirrors, and that's the one that this is actually still mounted on the roof of building 5800. Concentrating solar thermal addresses your question, sir, about how do we deal with energy storage to get around the fact that we have this phase delay between our energy consumption peak and our solar energy production peak. I've not used this slide in a long time, so bear with me a minute. So with concentrating solar thermal, the general wisdom at the time I put this slide together was that the installed cost per kilowatt was significantly less than photovoltaics, and more importantly, that these have the potential for energy storage, which even for a few hours can be very significant. Because again, if we can just get past that phase delay, there's a huge advantage for even short-term storage. Now, I back up and just say on this statement, at the time I put this slide together, which was probably 5 years ago, you could install a ground-mounted megawatt system for probably $9 a watt or so, and you could install, in principle, a concentrating solar system, solar thermal system, for maybe, I'm sorry, I may have said $4 a watt for the CSP system, versus $9 a watt for a megawatt class photovoltaic system. So in other words, this was significantly less expensive. In the last 5 years, photovoltaic costs, installed costs, have come down pretty significantly, and there are some pretty impressive incentives. So right now, you can install a photovoltaic system for about $4 a watt also. Concentrating solar thermal systems basically fall into three different categories. There are power towers, parabolic troughs, and parabolic dishes. These typically will use working fluids, which range from water to oil to molten salt, which is an interesting one. We still have systems out there that use Stirling engines, but Stirling engines have typically been problematic and have not really made it well in the mainstream, but they still are out there. They still are contenders. These are some representative systems I wanted to show you. This is Nevada Solar One. So if you drive out to Las Vegas and are driving, I think it's south of Las Vegas, you'll pass this nice, impressive facility. Maybe probably arrange a tour of it. I have not had the chance to tour this one yet, but this is about 300 acres of concentrating collectors. This went online in June 2007. At the time it did, it was the largest CSP plant. Had a 64 megawatt output capacity. So when you start looking at that in terms of land area, you'll find that it still takes about 5 acres per megawatt. This system cost $266 million to build, about $4 per watt. This used a 71% or 71-to-1 concentration ratio with an oil working fluid. This particular system uses no thermal storage. This is one of the coolest, in my opinion, concentrating solar systems that you'll see. This one is in Seville, Spain. This is the PS20, which superseded the PS10. And this one uses a water working fluid. It creates steam. This system only has short-term thermal storage, but it does. You can store thermal energy for about an hour, which is not enough to really help you beat the phase delay between consumption and production, but it is enough to let you overcome the challenge of passing clouds. It gives you enough time to recover by bringing other production resources online if you encounter clouds. All right, Solar 1 and Solar 2. Now, this was actually constructed in 1981. It was reconstructed in 1995, and then it was decommissioned in 1999 and was demolished a couple of years ago. But it was a very cool-looking system. This system was a 10-megawatt molten salt system, and this one actually had energy storage of a few hours. There were some other examples, but I think I've only included those few. So, if I hurry, we'll finish on time. All right, so let me just summarize by saying that solar energy is an important component of our energy future. The direct use of solar affords us the greatest energy efficiency because we avoid the conversion losses. Crystal and silicon, like it or not, is the most efficient means for a direct conversion of sunlight to electricity at this time and for the foreseeable future. Emerging thin film products, especially CadTel and SIGS, will be a significant player in the global energy scenario because there are places where large systems at 10% efficiency are perfectly acceptable. Solar thermal, where it's applicable, and I say where it's applicable because concentrating solar systems are not practical in regions like ours, except maybe a low concentration system because of the atmospheric haze we have, which produces low-angle scatter, which makes it very difficult to collect and concentrate that light at a high concentration ratio. So where applicable, the solar thermal systems really are the optimum solution for large-scale utilities in terms of installed costs and in terms of the ability to provide energy storage. So again, if you have questions, I'll be glad to stick around and answer things. Yes? So the question is, do I foresee that in the future we will integrate photovoltaic modules into electric cars so that the sun becomes a major resource for recharging the vehicle? And the answer, in my opinion, is that the area required is too large to be practical. Now, there is a little solar panel on the back of the Nissan Leaf that's actually used to manage a little ventilation system. So that when the sun is shining on the car, this little ventilation system actually kicks in and helps keep the car cooler so that you don't have to drain as much battery energy with cooling. That's a pretty practical use of solar. But in terms of providing enough energy to power a vehicle, one of the exercises that I like to give my students is if you assume 1,000 watts per meter squared and assume a 15% efficient solar module, and assume a little airplane like a Cessna 172 has, let's say for the sake of discussion, 150 horsepower engine. Do the math on how big the wings have to be to carry enough solar to drive that engine. And I don't recall the number. I won't try to give you the answer, but you will be impressed and you will realize the impracticality of that solution. But again, numbers you'll want to keep in mind, 1,000 watts per square meter, 15% conversion efficiency, 80% DC to AC conversion efficiency, and you can take those few numbers and do math on a lot of possible applications, and you'll realize why there are a lot of things said in the popular media that I think can be misleading, and there's not enough information for people to make really good rational decisions. So that's one reason I like to give these seminars. Yes?
Can you give it some dollars to grid-flight power shift or some of the more flight
No. Typically, I give seminars within the ORNL campus and at UT and in the city of Knoxville, but I've not specifically gone out to talk to activist groups of any kind. Do you want to, I mean, may I ask why you ask, or do you have a thought in mind? I see your point. I am preaching to the choir here. That's a real good point. I would make the offer that if you find a relatively non-hostile group that would be willing to have a seminar, I would be willing to provide a seminar for them, as long as I take bodyguards. Yes, Kofi. So the question is really about thin film efficiency. Do I expect to see it improving significantly? I think that it is improving pretty significantly with the SIGS technology, in the sense that we're already up to 19.5% efficient cells. We're still almost certainly going to be limited by the Shockley-Kaiser limit in terms of what we can do with single junction cells. There is no thin film technology that I am aware of anywhere on the horizon that looks promising, that looks more promising in terms of efficiency than SIGS does. Yes. Great question. Has anybody looked at the phase lag between production and usage in terms of the effect of daylight savings time? I'm sure the answer is yes. I don't know. I've not seen that result, but it's a good question because obviously there would be. It's throwing an hour onto that phase lag one way or the other. Yes.
In light of the recent hailstorms, do you have any data on people who have had installations that were affected, and how did the installations come out of that?
Rats. I knew I should have studied. Actually, I have been meaning to make some phone calls. I did talk to a solar installer a couple of days ago, and we talked about a lot of topics. I mean, I've got a very close relationship with the solar installer community. I have not heard about any damage. I wish I had a better answer for you than that. Right into the sustainable campus, we always try to respond on short notice. I will try to get you an answer on that one. Yes?
Low light incidence angles on simple solar cells more negatively affect their efficiency.
So the question is, do low angle incident light on thin film products result in lower efficiency than a comparable angle effect on silicon? Is that
right? Like for fixed still systems, I think we're going to have variation in your light incident angle. I think could be misleading maybe to represent efficiencies 10% to 25, but in the application, the efficiency really is also not tilt angle, but angle is more along the case. So I think that's in popular.
Okay, so the question really gets to, are we comparing apples and apples when we talk about the efficiency of thin film solar products versus crystalline silicon products? And in this case, his question was specifically directed to the influence of angle of incidence for a fixed system. And I'm not aware, it's a great question, and as an optical engineer, it makes a lot of sense to me to think about that one and address what the angle of incidence effect is. I just haven't seen the information. The information that I have seen, which is supposed to be more compelling for thin film than it is for single crystal silicon, is that there is anecdotal information, and people claim there's hard data, though no one's sent it to me yet, There is anecdotal information that says that amorphous silicon thin film products perform better in low light conditions than single crystal or multicrystal silicon. So I'm aware of that distinction. But that's all, and again, that's anecdotal. But sorry, I can't give you a better answer. Yes? Well, yeah, so the question has to do with these high concentration systems, which actually have concentrations of, in some cases, I think 700. The Aminex system may actually have a 700-to-1 concentration ratio. And so the question is, what does that do to the efficiency of the silicon cell? Because all electronic components, virtually all, become less efficient as they become hotter. It is the thermal management associated with these systems is an important part of the entire system. If it were practical to provide refrigeration on these systems to really keep the cells cooler, then there would be a substantial improvement in the efficiency. But you have to have the whole system be cost effective. So what they do is, like on the Aminex system, there is a lot of energy put into the passive thermal management in terms of really just heat sinks and how the thermal conduction paths are handled. But your question is, pun intended, spot on. Yes? So I think if I were summarizing the question, effectively what we're asking is, when we hear about efficiency and life cycle costs for solar systems versus nuclear plants versus coal plants, are we really looking at the whole package? Because we have to take the cradle-to-grave costs associated with each of these things into account, which includes a lot of environmental effects. And the answer is no. And this is one of my concerns, and this is one of the reasons that I try to get more information out into the public. We have so much in the popular media. Our information sources are basically driven by various industries and or factions, each of which has their own particular axe to grind, if you will. And I understand that, and I believe in freedom of speech. I like the fact that we have that, but at the same time, I feel that what is really missing is more publicly available, credible debate and data. I want people to know how to sort the ponies from the unicorns in the world, okay? Because there are a lot of unicorns out there, and a lot of people can't tell a unicorn from a pony. Well, if we've got a way of providing people with information sources that we, you know, that really are credible, and that they know they can take to the bank, then I think that's where we need to be focusing people's attention. Unfortunately, it's human nature. We want a mantra. We don't really want to have to think a lot. We want to find a mantra that we can just chant and feel better. And a lot of popular media is basically providing that mantra in one way or another so that people never get beyond the mantra and dig for the information. So what I hope we will do is become better. We will choose to better educate ourselves and choose to better educate each other through reasonable debate and less rhetoric. Let's see. I'm sorry. I think I neglected a question up here in the front row.
Do you think we'll see technological advances in DC
It's a great question. So, I've talked about the DC to AC conversion losses, and so the question is, will we see DC appliances coming forth that enable us to use our DC energy from solar directly without having to go through the DC to AC conversion losses? And I was a proponent of that approach some time back. Very often what's happening, I'm finding, is that I start out as a proponent in something, and then I become more engaged in it as a researcher, and I wind up undoing a lot of information that I thought at one time was valid. Here's the information that I get about DC appliances and the use of them with DC solar systems. For the most part, we're going to have a converter, whether it be a DC to AC converter or a DC to DC converter, and the efficiency of DC to AC converters is actually quite high. The inverter itself, seeing things on the market in the 96% efficiency range is not uncommon. I am told by Barack Ospanici, who is our power electronics guru, one of them, that DC to DC conversion in many cases is less efficient than DC to AC conversion. So there may not be, though it is intuitively compelling, there may not be a real advantage to going to DC appliances. Yes? Lifetime of a photovoltaic system is typically given at about, the warranted lifetime of a photovoltaic system is that it will produce 80% of its nameplate capacity at the end of 25 years. That is the typical, that's the typical rating. Now, we fully expect them to be productive many years beyond that. I don't think it's unreasonable to expect them to be producing something at 50 years, but they will be declining X percent per year, and I have to go back and think about that one to give you a percentage. The other thing to take into account, more importantly, is the inverter. And when we do the life cycle cost analysis for a photovoltaic system or do the economics on it, I always factor in one inverter replacement during the cost, during the lifetime, 25-year lifetime of the solar system. In many cases, you may just be able to repair the inverter, but I just go ahead and factor in the full replacement cost of the inverter. On the back row. In terms of a solar photovoltaic system, typically we refer to anything other than the photovoltaics as the balance of system, and I think the inverters are probably an area that is ripe for efficiency improvements or cost reductions. I mean, the efficiency is already quite good. The material costs and the energy costs in the photovoltaic modules is probably the hard rock in that situation. So. Probably harder to get the cost down more rapidly on the photovoltaics. Though I should recall that this is being videotaped, and I am a DOE employee, so our projection is that we will be at grid parity by 2015. Al?
My question is about the system, the advance that was recently announced in, I guess, RNL today, concerning drawing fibers in order to get the very short distances between where the various processes go on electronically to improve quantum efficiency. What do you think of the cost, the economics of that in the long run?
So in terms of using optical fibers to transmit signals within integrated circuits, that is certainly something that's being considered. I think integrating fiber optics into photovoltaic modules may not be practical.
I may have misunderstood the system. I thought it was just a way of getting very, very short distances between the different electronic components of a solar cell so that you didn't have very long transport distances, and that it had nothing to do with optical fibers. Bart Smith worked on this.
Okay. I am not familiar with the work, so I'm going to have to plead ignorance on that one. But if you've got information, I'll be glad to look at it and comment. Yes, front row.
Could you comment on manufacturing of the actual material
So the question is there a vibrant market for solar materials in the U.S.? I'm so glad you brought this up. Actually, the coolest thing is happening right now in our region. Within the last 18 months or so, we have Wacker Chemie announcing that they're going to move into the area. We have Hemlock Solar announcing they're going to move into the area. Those are both polysilicon manufacturers. Polysilicon is the rock-like, highly pure silicon starting material for making photovoltaic modules, making photovoltaic cells. Those manufacturers are going to be moving into Clarksville and Cleveland, Tennessee. When those are online, Tennessee will be the world's largest supplier of polysilicon. We have more recently heard the announcement that Confluence Solar is moving into Clinton, Tennessee. Confluence Solar will be using polysilicon like that produced by those two manufacturers to manufacture single crystal silicon boules using the Sokralski method. Those are the boules that ultimately get sliced into wafers. We do not have a photovoltaic cell manufacturer in Tennessee yet using those wafers. However, we do have a fantastic photovoltaic cell manufacturer in the Atlanta area, Suniva, who makes some of the best photovoltaic cells in the world. They sell them to the rest of the world. We do have a photovoltaic module manufacturer in Tennessee, in West Tennessee. That's Sharp Solar, but they are assembling their modules from cells made in Japan. We also have Asahi Flat Glass, who makes very, very flat glass that is used for things like flat screen televisions, but also as the front surface glass for photovoltaic modules. So yes, we have a industrial base for solar manufacturing that is not only not going offshore, it's growing domestically and it's growing here in our backyard. And I expect it to continue growing. And it probably shows, but I'm kind of excited about that. Sure, I appreciate it, and feel free also to send questions into Sustainable Campus. If they all come in at once, it may take me a little while to get back to you on them, but we will try to get them answered.
I didn't even catch your flat foot there.